We are going to talk about implanting microchips. Is this a good idea, or are we heading down a dangerous path? My name is Tyler Cohen Wood. I spent 13 years working for the Department of Defense in various capacities. I have written a couple of books. I'm working on a new book right now too. And they say I'm quite the cyber expert, so that is me.
All right, and my name is Scott Schober. I'm the president and CEO of Berkeley Varitronics Systems. We're a 46-year-old privately held company. We focus mostly on wireless technologies, dealing initially back in the 80s with the wireless build out, cell towers and cell phones, what makes signals propagate to make our phones work. Deal a lot with cybersecurity also. Also an author of a book called Hacked Again, and then recently joined a company as an advisor for block safe technologies, securing the blockchain.
Actually, one quick thing, sorry. Okay. I just started a new job too. The company is called Cyber Vista, and I am helping to develop some of the content in the courses. So.
Now this discussion is, I think, an interesting one when we think about implants, because obviously it really affects probably each and every one of us in this room, whether we realize it or not. Because why? We all have different political views, different scientific views, different views of security, maybe even in moral and ethical views. So you may be for it, you may be against it, it may be dangerous, and it's unfolding a lot more as technology advances and the use cases increase. And we'll get into some of that as we delve into this discussion here. And then Tyler, why don't you start us off there?
Sure, did you switch? Okay.
Yeah.
So there are different types of implants, and some of them will use different protocols. Some, a good chunk of them are passive, such as the one the gentleman has in his hand. And some are also active and passive. And they have a epoxy resin that helps keep it safe, a biological thing so that it doesn't explode and you don't get like all kinds of things running through your system. It's the size of a grain of rice, and it's injected into this fleshy part of your hand. And I think you get to choose your hand, right? Okay. Now, it's important to also note that these devices are not battery powered. They don't have a power source. They use an electromagnetic field, and they communicate back and forth with a reader. And how they really work is you have the tag, and then you also have readers and writers that can activate the tag. They can read information off of the chip, and they can also write information onto the chip too. And a lot of these readers and writers are very easy to make. There's a lot of applications available for them as well.
Now, there's an interesting company you probably heard of, Dangerous Things, and some of you may have read a lot of articles on it. I think they've got a pretty cool offering where they actually provide a kit where you can actually get a 13.56 megahertz tag. I think it's called a XNT tag, and it's about $99, the base kit, and it's got the actual syringe or whatever, so you can inject it, and all the medical apparatus you need to actually implant it safely. It is something that you have to do in a sense yourself or with somebody that's qualified to do it, because there's a level of risk obviously there. It's not necessarily approved by any certain agencies, FDAs or any of these others. So yeah, it's something that people do have to think about before they just jump in. One of the most common questions I get often, and you may even ask it yourself, can you be tracked by an implant? Do people track you? Well, not necessarily, because what do you need to do? You need to be very close proximity to it. What are you more likely to get tracked by? It's your mobile phone. Mm-hmm. Really, our mobile phone is one of the easiest ways to track each and every one of us. Why? Because we have a digital footprint based upon how the signals propagate, and we have our Wi-Fi on, our Bluetooth, all these other wireless technologies on there, as well as near-field communication for contactless payments if you're using Google Wallet, or if you're using Apple Pay, which I like to use myself. Certainly our phones are a rich source to actually track people there. Now, there's a lot of reasons why people can use these implants. And we'll get into it a little bit deeper, but one of the most common reasons I think that we put out there is it saves time. Think about the different use cases that there are. And again, Tyler will delve into it a little bit more myself. But if you're standing in line, just something as simple as getting on an airplane, it takes time. Where's my boarding pass or my e-ticket? Where's my phone? The app didn't load, whatever the case may be. It doesn't seem like much or it seems very minimal. But now when you look at the millions of passengers that are traveling each and every day, you could start to see some of the positive impacts for implants when you need to not have to wait in long lines, not have as many people within a corporation that have to scan your boarding pass on and so forth.
I will add one thing.
Okay.
In the future, tracking could definitely be something that's possible depending on how many readers get set up and how much this catches on, because then you could be tracked based on what readers you're hitting.
Yeah, and I guess close proximity. At first it seems, who's going to get that close to actually, and it's only a couple centimeters, I believe, for it to effectively work when you're actually trying to scan near-field communication technology. But think about it, if you're familiar with a relay hack, that's a common way that thieves are stealing cars right now. They could take a little black box, and one person will stand right next to your car, very close. The other person has another black box, and they'll follow you, assuming that you have your key fob on you. And then basically, it's kind of performing almost like a man-in-the-middle attack, extending that signal there. So it allows you to get in close proximity. So imagine that same thing with an implant. Somebody gets very close proximity, and now they could read or write or cause other havoc to somebody that does have an implant. So theoretically possible, yes, certainly. Is it happening each and every day? No, probably not. The next one, yeah.
All right, so what are some of the things these implants can do? And some of these things I'll discuss are potential future uses of them as well. So obviously, you can use them to log onto a computer. The Swedish rail system has, I think, 50,000 people who have the implants so that they can use it, their Metro card, to ride the Swedish rail. I don't know how many of you guys have your Metro card and you can never find it, you always lose it. Well, this way, you're never going to lose it. So it's used for that. It could be used for passports. It could be used for entering a building. Now, there is a company, it's called Three Market Square, and they're based out of Wisconsin. Now, last year, they had an implant party, and they offered for their employees, if they wanted, to get, they would pay for the implant, and the implant would give them access to the building, it would give them access to log on to their computers, and it would also give them access to pay for things downstairs in the cafeteria. And what I found to be interesting is that over half of their headquarter employees jumped at the chance to get one. So they got implanted, and there are lots of benefits. Like Scott had said, it's a lot faster. It's definitely identified as you. But there are some hacks that are available. And I want to read you a quote from the CEO of Three Square Market. He says, there's really nothing to hack in it because it's encrypted, just like credit cards are. The chances of hacking into it are non-existent because it's not even connected to the internet. The only way for somebody to get connectivity to it is to chop off your hand. How many of you think he's right? I think he is. And unfortunately, there are a couple of hacks that can be done with a lot of these chips. And Scott will go into some, and then I'll go into some others.
I was just going to share a couple other maybe use cases with implants first there. One that stood out in my mind was Scandinavian Airlines,
Which
I thought was kind of interesting. And somebody there, and it was more of a kind of tested out working with the airlines to see how well it worked, but he was able to actually get an implant in his hand. But then he didn't tell the people that were normally collecting the boarding passes and things like that, just to see what the reaction was. And they were a little startled when he walked up and just simply put his hand over there to the actual scanner there. And again, it was encrypted data, and he was able to put that on there. It was NFC technology, but it was really to work with the airlines there in Sweden to prove that, that it's possible to do these things. And it was kind of an interesting case. Another girl was talking about some of the things and shared what she's done with an implant. And if you're familiar with, I don't know if anybody has the Philips Hue system, the lighting system, I have that in my house. It's kind of cool, just gadgetry and fun, which works with Zigbee protocol and then Wi-Fi back. But you could also then tie that in, and what she did was tie it in with near-field communication and an implant. So you walk in a room, basically, wave your hand next to the reader, and what can happen? Boom, your lights go on or go off. Or you could do different things like that, load different information on them, which is kind of cool. And of course, if you have an Android phone, it's kind of a pain to lock and unlock your phone, isn't it? At least I hate it. You know, I was trying to biometric fingerprint, or what was my code again,
Scott,
so on and so forth.
You've gotten lazy.
Yeah, well, it is. Who here hates to unlock their phone? Anyone? Am I the only lazy person? I don't know. I find it kind of annoying sometimes when I want to do a quick picture, and I'm trying to futz with it, and you drop the phone. But in any event, that's another application there. Imagine here, you put the phone in your hand, and it's nice and close. Boom, it's an authenticator. It's convenient, and oftentimes we do what? We trade convenience for security, security for convenience, and that's a big problem. This helps with some of those problems there, and I think it's kind of neat. Now, how about anybody out there, crypto world? Anybody have any cryptocurrency? Anyone? A couple? Okay, a couple. There's another use case that at first it seems a little strange. What's one of the biggest problems with cryptocurrency? It's not really that cryptocurrency in itself is not secure or blockchain is not secure. It's the ecosystem. Wherever the vulnerabilities are, that's where hackers are going to exploit. Now, think about near-field communication and an implant, and now keeping your private key right here. Again, I don't think anybody's going to chop off your hand and they'll do those extreme type of things. But if you have your private key here, that's a pretty secure way to keep it. If you think about that from a standpoint, if you're buying and selling cryptocurrency, it makes sense. It's secure. Right. So there's one gentleman that has two implants, and he trades bitcoins and some other cryptocurrency, and he uses that basically as his to store his private key.
There are a few hacks that people have done right now, and again, I'll say not all of these devices are created equal. Some of them utilize different protocols, but some ways to actually get into them are through the phone. If you're using the phone to update it, someone else could be using that same phone, and we're going to show you how you could actually locate somebody and that you have the ability to clone one of those devices. Amongst other things, infill, exfill. Oh, one thing that we had thought about too, this is kind of interesting, and you could do this, but I don't recommend it. The chip can be used. How many people are concerned about the insider threat? Intentional, unintentional insider threat? Yes, we all are. Well, a lot of companies no longer allow you to bring thumb drives into the office. And you can use this device because they do have some storage space on them. You can hook a reader-writer into the computer, and then you can exfil information into your hand, and there you go. There's your intellectual property.
Yeah, and I'm not sure exactly what some of the implants they have. I think it's 888 megahertz megabytes that it has stored. Is that what yours is, sir?
Bytes.
Okay. So it's not a ton of information, but still, you could hold a lot
of
stuff on there.
Yeah.
Exactly. So it's basically a link, in a sense, right to the cloud, and boom. So yeah, if you start to think about it a little bit deeper, maybe than surface level, it's fairly powerful and allows you to do a lot of other things.
Yes.
And I think it's a lot of these unknown things that, to me, it gets me more excited. Does that mean I'm going to run out and get an implant? No. But I think for those that do, I understand the reason why they do. And perhaps it's for research, perhaps it's for curiosity, perhaps it's to make their life a little bit easier. But the more I look at it, the more I understand the reasons why. And that's what, hopefully, as we're discussing some of these, we want you to just think a little bit open today and understand the bigger picture, not just where we are now.
Mm-hmm. But where we'll be.
Yeah, but where the future might be. And that's where I think the door opens up to a lot of curiosity. So if nothing else, when you leave here today, hopefully you could meditate back and say, wow, I made it through the very last conference and stayed awake. We didn't put you to sleep. But where the future is going with implants, it's kind of exciting. Just like if we think about cryptocurrency or different type of malware, different type of hacks, that probably excites different parts of this audience. Mm-hmm. Same thing too with, I think, implants. It gets exciting when we think about what if, and that's the beauty of it. I'm gonna just spend, and I don't wanna dive in too deep technically, but there's a lot of different types of technology and frequencies, and I don't want to, again, cover the whole basis because we probably couldn't. That's another topic in itself. But in a general sense, most of the technology, we'll call it RFID, because really NFC is really, in a sense, a protocol layer part of RFID. It's a subset. Maybe that's an easy way of saying it. And passive RFID systems are what? Short range, very close. It's important to realize that when we think about our mobile phone or Wi-Fi or any other type of signals, how they propagate a far distance. Near field communication, RFID, traditionally it's really close range, close proximity, and it's important to realize that. Again, depending upon the type of technology, if it's passive and you've actually got energizing a field there with an antenna to send data and power back and forth, because as Tyler mentioned, you don't have to have a battery connected to this thing, which is kind of cool, right? Because it's energized through the magnetic field. That's very powerful when we think about it, because they're magnetically coupled devices. So we have to think a little bit differently than our traditional thoughts when we associate a mobile phone or anything like that. So think about that layer. Now again, I think we mentioned before, you can probably use an Android phone if you want to connect into an implant, near field communication, read and write, as this gentleman probably has an Android, I would assume.
There's not an Apple app yet, but there's one that can read, but they're working on it.
Yeah, there's nothing really.
To write to it.
It's, I guess, the Apple, and they're usually a closed system. And again, they're trying to keep it really for Apple Pay, near field communication, and control that ecosystem in itself. Where the future goes, we don't know. But as more things open up, I know they're getting a lot into the health areas and apps and things like that. I think it's another good use case I don't think we touched on. Imagine you're working out in the gym, and you think about an implant, and you want to know what your heart rate is. You want to know what your pulse is. You want to know your body temperature. Well, all those things could be simply talk to your phone, and you could look at that as you're working out or exercising, things like that. Again, could you do that with a wearable? Sure you can. Are wearables a little bit clunky when you're working out or running? Yeah, and they're damage and moisture and sweat and all those other things. So maybe there's a different use case there that we should at least consider. Again, very high frequency one there, 13.56 megahertz. It's also very common with a lot of the tagging and things that the DoD uses as well. Ultra high frequency, 800 to 915 megahertz. Very familiar with that. We build some spectrum analyzers for RFID for doing testing and things of the companies such as Walmart and others, where they've used a lot of tags and things there. And another interesting one that we shouldn't underestimate is Bluetooth. There are some Bluetooth implants and things that are actually out there. There's been a lot of work in the hearing aid where it's actually implanted behind your ear, and it's actually a Bluetooth implant. And it allows that to send information to your phone. And what's the advantage of Bluetooth? Well, traditional Bluetooth signals don't propagate really far. It is fairly close range, but certainly everybody in this room that has Bluetooth on their phone, I could say, be it an app or be it a scanner, Bluetooth low energy is a little more exciting because it doesn't use that much power. And if it's designed properly, it can last for years. And there again, you have what? The ability to transmit and receive. So you could store information, you could share information, and what else? You can hack information. So there's a fine balance there when people are looking at different technologies here for what they're looking for as far as implants.
Well, it's also important to keep in mind, and we'll get to the apply section of this, but something that is completely secure, or you feel it's secure right now, today, we've seen it will not be tomorrow. So it's something you have to, if you're gonna get the implant, you wanna make sure that you know the protocols it's using, you know how it's being used, and you're continuing with updates, and you're making empowered decisions on whether or not you wanna use put something like this inside of you, if the benefits outweigh the risks.
Yeah, I think Tyler makes a beautiful point too. Just thinking about IoT, we're all familiar with the Internet of Things. It's a common topic. We hear about it in all the headlines. Who feels that it's truly secure? 100% secure. You put IoT devices in your house, going. No, why? Because we know it's not secure. They're low-cost devices. They do some great stuff. Everything from your Nest thermostat to your refrigerator to your flushing toilet that tells you how many gallons of water went down.
But that's another presentation.
Yes. But think about IoT and how powerful that is. We know nothing is what? 100% secure. So NFC, 100% secure? No.
Well, it could be, because according to the CEO, if it's not connected to the internet, it's completely secure.
And we believe him.
So there's a lot of implants that also are medical implants, and everybody is familiar with these. And these are life-saving implants, but there can be insecurities with some of these implants as well. One that I can think of off the top of my head is some of pacemakers can be updated through an iPad. So if you're looking for points of vulnerability, you're going to hit the lowest hanging fruit, and that would probably be the iPad. So, and you can talk about some of the other.
Yeah, I had not too long ago, I was actually presenting at a cybersecurity conference, and I had an individual come up to me, I think after my presentation. It wasn't on this subject at all, but it was more on hacking, vulnerabilities, and things like that. And he said, and he leans over, he goes, "I've got two medical implants. I am scared to death of being hacked." Mm-hmm. He was working in a very specialized area of security, and he was afraid that if he was ever targeted, he could be compromised. And we had an interesting discussion of some of the actual vulnerabilities that are in fact there in the whole ecosystem, the way that the devices inside of his body would communicate close range, and then how that information was sent out via cellular modem, regular 4G LTE communication. Again,
and then
secure.
The endpoint devices that are being used by the doctors to read. So there's
vulnerabilities throughout the chain. I think that's what we have to realize and accept when you're going into it. That's a consideration that people have to certainly have. Okay. Well, maybe what we'll do is take a minute and just talk briefly about the Bluetooth protocol. Now, Bluetooth, again, can be used. I mentioned hearing aids. There's a whole bunch of different opportunities where companies are taking Bluetooth and they're actually integrating into different things. We didn't have anybody that was willing to take a Bluetooth implant, so we're going to...
We didn't know you yet.
And yours isn't Bluetooth, but that's okay. So what we're going to do is ask maybe Tyler to hold the teddy bear here as an example, just to kind of simulate it. But imagine that if you're a person now and you implement a small Bluetooth device inside of you. Difference again with Bluetooth, and we could assume it's Bluetooth low energy, so the battery, because Bluetooth does require some energy. It's not magnetically coupled in a sense where it's powered by a reader and it's got a battery inside it. It's running on 2.4 gigahertz, like our Wi-Fi that we're familiar with at home, if we have an access point or our phones. Bluetooth is similar, except again, it's a fast frequency hopper and it's going about 1,000 times per second hopping, which makes it a little bit more robust from noise and for jammers and things like that. But still, what do we know about Bluetooth? There are known exploits and hacks that are out there. So if somebody really wanted to cause havoc, they very well could. Now, simple tool that we developed here, and this is just for, again, demonstration purposes. Say you wanted to target an individual that had some type of implant, in this case, Bluetooth here. What you could do is you can actually scan, and I could scan and I could see on my screen all the different addresses. And then what I can do is hone in on one particular, which I happen to tap on, which is the ID that is on there. And let me flip it to the next screen so you can kind of see what I'm looking at. So the screen on the right there is an ID. And then it's got a friendly name and an actual address there. And then I can actually target the said unit here, which is a 2.4 gigahertz conical directional antenna, which has got some gain to hone in on a frequency. And then you can actually move in if you're looking for a target.
Yeah, there.
You probably can't hear it, but you could basically target based upon the sound and the signal strength intensity going up there.
So Bear has a Bluetooth implant. So if you were a bad guy and you were interested in doing something, hacking, whatever you wanted to do, you would know that Bear has that implant and you could use your tools against him in close proximity.
Yeah, and a lot of these systems, be it Bluetooth, be it Wi-Fi, be it different protocols, different agencies use to actually surveil people. Mm-hmm. And it's often done covert, it's body-worn equipment, it's directional antennas, but if somebody wants to target and hack somebody, what better way than using wireless technologies of one sort or another? And again, these are just things not to scare you, even though there's some things at these type of shows that scare us, but it just shows us what is possible out there. That's what's important. I think we want to switch to questions, don't we? We're allowed to do questions at the end, you said, right? Oh, okay, great. Let's wrap it up with this maybe, and then we'll hit some questions if anyone has any.
Okay. So what are the takeaways here? You want to do your research. I've said this a few times. You want to make sure you understand the protocols. You want to make sure you understand how the device is being updated and what the security risks are to it. And you also want to make it as secure as possible. If you have the ability to use encryption or a very strong password, you want to do that. And you also want to make sure you're reading the terms of service before you get the implant so you understand what the company is able to do if there's any information that's being gathered through your phone, through whatever it is that you use. You want to make sure that you are patching and that all of your firmware and software are up to date. Again, just because something is secure today does not mean it will be tomorrow. And we've seen that happen time and time and time again. And then again, just understand the protocols and the vulnerabilities and really make an empowered decision on if this is something that you want, because there's a lot of really cool things that these things can do. And I do think that we're going to get more and more and more of these implants in the future. I mean, people are implanting kids so that they can track them and find them if they get lost, which is, it could be a good thing, it could be scary, but it's up to you to make that decision with knowledge.
Yeah, excellent point. I think pets too. I know my sister had their dog implanted recently. It always runs away and they can't find it. And they want to be able to identify it and prove that it's their dog. So there's a lot of good, valid use cases. So now maybe one question before we ask you if you have any questions. Now looking back at some generalities and things that we did cover today, who here would ever consider getting an implant? Okay, so there's some hands now that might. That's
Bear.
Interesting.
Bear.
And Bear, too, yeah. So thank you guys again for staying with us. We know the last conference, the end of the conference is always a tough one, but you hung in there. We really do appreciate it. And if you have any questions, feel free to throw them at us, and we'll try our best to answer.
Okay, I have just two quick questions. One, you talked about, and this is my ignorance of the technology, that you have to be very close proximity to be able to read them.
Yes.
I'm thinking of the movie Big Hero 6 that my kids love, where Baymax could only read right here, and he increased the scanner to be able to scan the whole city at one time. Is it possible that there's technologies that could be where the scanners are more powerful and therefore could scan from a further distance?
Yeah, I could take that. Yes, certainly there is. Is that the way it's set up right now to be done with the traditional equipment? No. Is it possible? Yeah, but is it possible for real far distances? Probably not. We've got to be realistic.
At least not yet.
Yeah, maybe we're talking more like Bluetooth low energy distances where it's a matter of X number of feet. We're not talking, you know, the other side of the convention hall or anything like that.
But you can enhance the signal to distances that are beyond what is normal, but from really far away, probably not yet.
Okay, and just one more other one that I had was as far as hacking and things, you mentioned the example of a plane ticket where he scans it and puts his plane ticket on there. Mm-hmm. I just immediately think of the scenario of you've got two bad actors, they get through security, and then they can keep the names on there and swap their pictures and change planes.
Absolutely.
So there's all kinds of, what kinds of considerations or discussions are there about the potential for the negatives that are out there?
It's actually a huge debate, especially in the airline industry, Most of the major airlines are discussing it, arguing it's secure. No, it's not secure. Again, the easiest thing to say is nothing is 100% secure. But then again, how secure is your boarding pass? It really isn't. Yet what do we do with it after we get to our hotel room? We toss it in the garbage. Why? Because you could basically take an optical reading of that, right? A 3D barcode scan of it, and you can get more information than just Scott Schober. You can get additional layers of information. It's the layers of information that the bad guys, the hackers, gather. That's what's so valuable. Mm-hmm. So if they can get another piece of information on you, yeah, it could be used toward a hack. So there are vulnerabilities there, definitely.
But I do like your point. You know, there's not necessarily anything that could be stopping them from changing the picture or changing information on it if they have a reader writer, if they have the app that goes with it. So, you know, these are things that we're going to have to start taking into account as these become more prolific.
Yeah. And there is encryption too, something else to keep in mind. But as with anything, encryption has to get more advanced now, and everything is AES 256-bit encryption.
My quantum computer is going to take care of that. So we're
exactly. That'll put us in another challenge. Thank you.
So I want to ask you to prognosticate a little bit, Taylor. So, you know, I work as a contractor. You and I talked yesterday a bit about this. Doing a lot of DoD secure projects,
yes,
which means classified labs and such. Mm-hmm. I can see the value of like health industry, Apple Pay, Google Pay that you talked about, the gee whiz factor, things I can play with at home, you know, that are RFID or NFC controlled. But I'm having a hard time seeing the DoD, national governments from any country and any kind of a business with secure development areas for highly sensitive projects wanting to have this kind of technology available to their employees in these kinds of spaces. What are your thoughts on that?
My thoughts are for their employees, they wouldn't, because if someone is going into theater or going into a country, they're going to get scanned. You don't want anything that's going to identify them. But there are other use case scenarios in which the Department of Defense, the intelligence community, could actually utilize this to help enhance the mission. And if you want, I can go into those with you in a different room.
Maybe just to add to it, just to throw out something that pops into my mind immediately, look at personnel records within the government. And all I gotta say is OPM, the breach. It's very controversial, but think about that. And again, I'm not a proponent to criticize the government, since the government's my one of my best clients, but can they handle data for their own employees and keep it secure? Could a use case like this that's properly encrypted and controlled and contained be useful for that type of information? That's all I'm saying. Good, excellent question.
That was really good. Yes, sir?
Hi, thank you. I have a number of questions, so I'm just gonna keep floating to the back of the line if anyone wants to come get in the middle. So, like, besides deterring squeamish thieves, like, why would I implant something in my hand instead of a piece of jewelry, right? Like, I've had my wedding ring with me about all the times I've got my thumbs with me. Mm-hmm. So, like, I don't understand why an implanted thing is desirable.
Well, I mean, that's a great question, and some people do feel that way, but then you have other people that really do want the convenience of it and like the fact. And you know what? I'm actually going to ask you if you could answer that question.
Yeah, please.
Can you jump on the microphone? Because they're recording this whole thing. I'm sorry, okay. If you're okay with that.
We follow this with a rap battle, so I hope you're ready.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah, so I did it. I was more of curiosity to begin with. I mean, I read all the medical risks and things along with sticking something inside my body. But I like the idea of I never have to worry about losing it. I'm never going to steal it. No one's going to steal it. I have it encrypted. I control what's on it. It's easy to remove if I need to remove it. It's just a simple outpatient surgery, you know, just cut a hole, slice it out.
Sure.
It's not really invasive. The procedure to install it was super easy. My neighbor happened to be a nurse, so she injected it, watched a YouTube video, took 5 minutes. The risk is low.
Sure.
for getting it done. And plus, it costs less. You know, the chip, I think my whole kit was about $80. Yeah. So it came with everything I needed.
Wow.
So as opposed to buying like an NFC ring or something along those lines that I'll lose, get smashed, I can go through airport security with it. I can have MRIs. I've never had an issue, any medical reason not to have a scan cause a problem. I work for DOD. I go into SCIFs all the time. It's never been an issue.
Ooh. So you could bring a reader in there with you, a reader writer, and
I do. Yeah, I tell them. It's never been a problem.
Which means policy hasn't
caught up. Right. Yeah. Well, and that's a different problem entirely. Is policy just cannot keep up with technology?
Yeah, I tell the security managers, and they look at me, and they're like, "Oh, well, what does it do?" So they don't know what the chips are, and they've taken my word that I'm telling them the truth that it's just an NFC chip.
Yeah, it's more to keep the good employees honest, I guess, too, most SCIFs, because, and we deal with that every day. We provide wireless test tools to stop Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, and cellular threats. And NFC has come up. Can you detect USB sticks? Can you detect SIM cards? Can you detect everything under the sun? They want to be able to stop to keep out of an area that has classified information, so it's a good point. Maybe just to add to your comment, or question, I'm sorry, a comment, you mentioned about a ring. I never wore a ring my whole life until I got married. And to me, if I'm working in the machine shop or hands-on on the bench soldering or something, it's kind of a pain. Now, I can't get my ring off. I'm married, 23 years? I should know this. My wife likes that, but it gets crushed often. I closed the door once on it and hurt my finger because my ring was on. It got stuck and it all swollen up and a couple of the diamonds fell out and I had to get it fixed while I'm holding my hand there. So it inconvenience, maybe one could say. Same thing, I never wore a watch, but once I got the Apple Watch, I said, I'm going to wear a watch. So you make adjustments because technology is cool, it's convenient, it's fun, and maybe that's why some people will tend to go over to the next level with an implant.
Okay.
You had another question, or you?
I've got a couple more.
Oh, you can jump to the back of the line in the hiss. Keep going, that's all right. Please.
Just real quick, related to that, he was talking about, you know, jewelry and things. Isn't there something about tattoos where they're doing that, where they will imprint technology on a tattoo?
I have heard of that, yes.
So that could also be a permanent option.
Yeah.
Still involves a needle, but.
Yes.
Yeah, it's more semi-permanent, I guess, because it's in the layers of the skin and it's just embedded, but it can come out too if you had to.
Sure. So this is a topic I follow just really casually, so I kind of don't know what's out there. Do they have any chips that can, like, give off enough public key kind of information to convince you that it's really me, but not give away enough that someone could duplicate it if they could read it? Does that make sense? Like, how much?
It does. It does.
Like, does that exist, or is all there is today just here's a serial number, and anybody that can read that serial number can emit the same serial number?
Yeah. It is possible. I don't know of a chip that is doing that right now. There aren't a ton of them. Are you familiar with any? Because I'm not.
Assume the level or the amount of information that you want to put on there, you control. So to some degree, that's important to think before you load up on an implant information that could be possibly compromised.
Right. And similar on the compromise thing, like, is there any ability, or did you want to go ahead?
Go ahead.
Is there any ability to say, like, hey, it's going to be available to broadcast, but like only when I squeeze it for a second first, right? Like that it's only participating when I want it to instead of just when I'm like holding onto the subway rail.
No, not really. Because again, how is it controlled? It's when you come in close proximity, and I don't want to get into a deep technical discussion, but the magnetic energy is sending power and data is being transmitted back and forth. But to do that, you have to be very close proximity with it. But it's not like there's a switch and on and off or anything like that.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
As of now.
Yeah.
It may be different later.
Yeah. So this kind of begs the question, and maybe Billy can help answer it as well, is we have a product that has a fixed technology embedded in my web of my hand or whatever. As with anything that's in technology, technology keeps moving along. Software keeps moving along. How upgradable is it? And what kind of path would that actually take? Or is it just fixed capability and what you got is what you got?
I don't think that they're fixed capabilities, and this gentleman could probably also answer from his own experience, but what I've read is the updates will come through a computer, through a phone, and that's how you'll get your updates. I don't know if yours is different.
When it comes to just adding and removing information, yeah, I can update through my phone, but when you're talking about the physical limits of the device, yeah, there's a 888 bytes is all I got. So if I want to upgrade that, I have to remove the chip, put in a new chip.
Oh.
Yeah, so scalpel works good.
So when I think about the chips, I think about the sleeves that they usually give you when you have a card or some sort of chip. Is there any way that you could potentially wear a glove that could make it so it's not necessarily contactless? Because I think of a sleeve, I also think of a glove.
Yeah.
I haven't. Have you run into a lot of sleeves that work really, really well? Because...
Well, in essence, when you think about any type of radio frequency, because that's what we're really talking about here, you have to put a Faraday cage over something to really block or eliminate. A lot of us are familiar with the little sleeves you put a credit card in so nobody could hack you, supposedly. But in reality, probably everybody's credit card in their wallet right now, whether, again, you have a sleeve or not, it's not an RFID credit card, so it doesn't matter. So nobody's going to hack it.
Right.
Everybody believes that their cards could be hacked by somebody walking up close to you and hacking you. Really not the case. The sheer number of cards out there is almost nothing. So that's one thing to keep in mind. Yeah. There are hats. In fact, we're in our labs. We're doing some testing on hats and different clothing, key fobs, everything under the sun that basically is trying to create a Faraday cage to protect any radio frequency from penetrating or getting in and out. So theoretically, could you cover something up there like a Faraday cage? Absolutely. You could and block the communication to a degree.
I think it comes down to just common sense and responsibility. You don't walk around with a driver's license on your t-shirt.
Yeah.
So don't put stuff on your chip that you don't want being affected. Assume it's going to be taken or hacked, and then think back from there and go, all right, I don't put my home address on my chip. Yeah. So I might put my business address because I can trade business cards with it, but I don't put my personal cell phone number. I'll put my work number. I think that's how I approach what I put on. As I assume it's already going to be stolen, compromised, manipulated.
That's a great point. And you think about it, implants, we think of permanency and we get scared. A tattoo, an implant, permanency. But you control what goes on there and what you take off there. So it's really in your power not to put something that's going to be compromising there that could be hacked or blocked, whatever.
But you also don't want someone else putting something on it that you didn't want put on it too.
Yeah.
So maybe they'll come out with a bodysuit, a Faraday bodysuit, and, you know.
I'm sorry, I might have missed. I'm curious, how are you using that chip? And the other question is, how do you decide, is there a limit as to where you can put it? Implant it in your body. I mean, is there some spots you don't want to?
Well, there are spots.
Yes.
I can assure you there are definitely spots you don't want to put it. But typically they're put here. That's where yours is, right?
Yeah,
I haven't actually heard of them being put elsewhere. I know on horses and pets they can put it in different places because obviously they don't have this fleshy bit in a thumb, but yeah, as of now, I think they're just being put in this bit right here.
And again, how are you using it? Are you using it for scanning to get in a building or whatever, security? Or
it kind of just depends on what I'm doing. If I'm going to a conference, I usually put a contact card on it. So if people have NFC on their phones, if I run out of cards, I can just scan their phone. It adds a contact right in. If I'm doing talks or something, I'll put cat videos on it or something silly just to show you can, you know, attach to a YouTube video. I've played around with Bitcoin wallets. I use it for identification for like Arduino. So I build Arduino things with lights that flash, and I'll scan it just to program things with it. I mean, I just play with it. It's just something cool to play with. And when I get bored with it, I can have it removed. Yeah. Cut
my hand. Do you know when Tile is going to come out with one so I can find my teenagers whenever I want?
Well,
is that technology coming to where you can implant a Tile or something?
Well, I mean,
you technically could.
Yeah, you certainly could, and also you could also put things on the phone because I'm gonna guarantee they've always got the phone on them.
Yeah, yeah. The phone again goes back to tracking even more than a GPS tracker. If you ever want to find your child, put the apps on the phone. They'll always be glued to their phone and never let it go. I think we have time for one more question, so please go ahead.
Hello. I was just wondering, is there a level of authentication in these implants? Like, would someone else be able to flash your implant, or can only you flash yours?
Yes, someone else is able to flash your implant. As of now, with some. Mm-hmm. Do we have any other questions?
I thought you said one more. But,
please, go ahead.
But I was wondering, is it because of the low power that it doesn't have the power to deal with algorithms associated with encryption and authentication? When you talk about doing a authentication or those type of things, is that done on the chip or is it done on the component that's feeding power into the chip?
Well, it's going to depend on what chip you're using, what protocol you're using. Have you seen?
No, but I guess the answer is a little differently. Again, remember, it's magnetically coupled, and that'll energize it, which then allows it to spit back information. So it's really, I kind of call it dormant. It's sitting in this gentleman. It's not doing anything right now. It's dormant. Until you could bring something here to activate it, basically, the magnetics, then it will start spitting data out. So you're powering it and communicating. So it's a little bit different means than what we talked about, Bluetooth protocol, where it's a transceiver talking back and forth, and there's a protocol being spit back and forth. That makes any sense. But, okay.
All right.
Well, I think that's time up. Thank you guys again for hanging in there. Appreciate it.
Thank you guys.